Just to impress upon you how impressed I am with the lecturer, how seriously I'm treating it. See, I'm wearing a jacket, I'm putting on a tie. Okay, so it's really a distinctive pleasure and honor for me to introduce Professor Kandel. We grew up together professionally. He got his doctorate in 1972, I got my doctorate in 1973, so he's my big brother. Not from the same professor, but that's what I mentioned to you yesterday about the importance of networking. Here, the guy sitting next to you, you could be interacting with him for the rest of your career. And they would be much better than you, so you say, okay, take care of me, something like that. So Professor Kandel got his doctorate, again, 72 from Caltech, from the legendary Frank Marbo. I don't know whether you guys know Frank Marbo. He's really, again, legendary in terms of combustion and propulsion. And then afterwards, he went back to France. Currently, he has been professor at Ecole Centrale Paris, the top university there, and been doing all sorts of outstanding work, combustion noise, acoustics, and all that. It's world authority in this, and has been getting the medals from the institute, the silver medal for best paper, and the Zeldovich medal?
And the Zeldovich. Yes.
That's the top medal. From the institute, and in terms of his recognition, he is a member of the French Academy of Sciences and also a member of U.S. National, foreign member, U.S. National.
Of engineering.
Of engineering, but perhaps even more significant, he is the president-elect of the French Academy of Science. You know how significant that is, right? The top person. Especially in France, because France, they really focus emphasis a lot on theories, mathematics, and all that pure science. To have one of us to be elected there not only says how important and how much Professor Kandel is being respected in that country, but also it's also good for us for the field, because people always think combustion, right? It's not. So really, really pure science, but they recognize the importance of the work. And we hope certainly Professor Kandel would spread the message of combustion in France and of course all this time throughout the world. So I wouldn't talk some more, so I just pass the podium to him and look at that. So he's all yours and you're all his. And I told him, if he wants to keep on talking, he can cancel the break, okay? You guys are his now. All right.
Thank you, Ed. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a great honor for me as well to participate to this lecture. And you are a wonderful person. You've organized that, and it's remarkable. And so I'm very glad to be here. And I was, last year, I gave the lecture at Tsinghua, and Ed Lowe was organizing that as well. Mm-hmm. And so it's really nice. And my thanks and congratulations for this. Okay, thank
Enjoy.
You.
Enjoy.
Thanks.
You
thank you.
Yes. I can just turn
yeah. All right, so I'm going to lecture on combustion dynamics. My associates, now science is not done by your own. You have to collaborate. You have to you work as a team. And my group, my team is shown here. I am closely working with Daniel Durox. He's a research engineer from CNRS. And my co-worker is Professor Thierry Schuller. We've been working together for a number of years. Of course, we have a number of students. This is not the only people that I'm interacting with, but they are important. So also I wanted to thank again Professor Ed Lowe for organizing this and asking me to give this lecture. My students who have worked in this field are Nicolas Noiret, Paul Paliès, these are recent students, Frédéric Boudy, Jean-François Bourgoin, Jonas Moek has been a postdoctoral fellow in our lab. Kevin Prieur is now working with us, and we had also a visitor from Italy, Davide Laera, and he has been working with us in the recent period. So you see, what we are going to do here is to work on combustion dynamics, and especially the dynamics of various flames, but one of them is quite important, is swirling flames, flames that are set into a rotating motion. You know that this is used for stabilizing combustion in gas turbines, for example, or in many other situations. To stabilize flames, we have them rotate, and as a consequence, the gases are recirculating, and hot gases recirculating stabilize the flame. What I'm saying here also is that this is a very large topic, and even with 15 hours, you don't cover the whole thing. It's too complicated, and so one would need at least, I don't know, 3 or 4 times that. So this is just a short course in combustion dynamics. What I'm going to do is first give introductory comments and also tell you a little bit about the school where I'm teaching, where I'm doing research. It's not well known to you, but you will see we have some very famous alumni. So like that, you will know about École Centrale. Then we will look at a few examples of combustion dynamics just to get ideas of what happens in the lab. How do flames respond to perturbations? What happens when they are perturbed, especially by acoustics? And then we will ask ourselves, why is combustion so susceptible to instabilities? This is a problem of combustion, and why is it so, and what are the main reasons for that? We'll look at the classification of combustion instabilities. This is also a topic. We want to know how to distinguish the various ways combustion interacts with the perturbations. And one slide to give a timeline, but it's really very limited. And then we will look at the objectives and see and start working on the equations, especially the equations of acoustics, because acoustics is a big part of the problem. So just to tell you about our school, this school is located south of Paris. You can see the red spot there is École Centrale. This is where I work. Very close by, there is a beautiful park, Parc de Sceaux. It's a few miles outside Paris, not far from Orly. So, and in fact, to come here, I took a plane from Orly, an Air France plane, which goes to New York. And so in 7 hours, I was here. So just a little bit of commuting, and you're here. And the way back is also possible. So, and you see Eiffel, the man who built the Eiffel Tower, he was an alumni of our school. He's an engineer from École Centrale. And of course, the Eiffel Tower. Who does not know the Eiffel Tower? Have you been on the Eiffel Tower, or have you seen the Eiffel Tower? Well, anyway, it's a beautiful monument. It was built in 1889 to celebrate the French Revolution, and it's now in Paris. They thought they would build it and then bring it down because it was for a universal exposition, but they kept it. You know, and so Paris now, you cannot think of Paris without the Eiffel Tower. Another famous person from our school is Colonel Rozanov. You know that the sound barrier was crossed by who crossed the sound barrier in the United States? Chuck Yeager. And that was in 1947. And in 1954, Constantin Rozanov crossed the sound barrier in France on a French airplane. Mr. Quatre from Dassault. By the way, you know that aeronautics was begun by the very famous flight of the Wright brothers, and that was in 1903. And just 6 years, at that point, there was a very strong connection between France and the United States. The Wright brothers came to France showed their aircraft, and there was a lot of enthusiasm in France for aeronautics. People were flying everywhere, little aircraft, trying to have them fly and go from one place to another. And 6 years later, we had Louis Blériot. Blériot crossed the English Channel. You know, the distance is not so large, but that was the first time that you would go from France to England by plane, and that was in 1909, just 6 years after the Wright brothers. And Blériot was very famous for that. Blériot, of course, was an alumnus from École Centrale as well. He's another very famous engineer. He built, after doing that, he won a prize, and he built 10,000 aircraft in his life. So he became a leader in industry and built aircraft. And this is how Airbus is rooted. You know, it's the fact that aeronautics was very strong at that point. Why Blériot was able to cross the channel like that? Because he had the best propulsion systems, the best engines of the time. They were twice as effective. The performance was the power per volume, and this power was twice that of any other engine at that time. So when you have a good engine, it's very useful. And of course, the engine doesn't work without combustion. It's not yet. Of course, you can fly electrical engines, electrical aircraft. You've seen that one has made the whole world. The solar impulse went around the world, but with a single pilot, and it took a lot of time and effort. So basically, at this point, engines only fly because of combustion. There is no other possibility to do aeronautics. So now let's go to my topic. This gave you just a little bit an idea of what is École Centrale. In fact, École Centrale has merged with another school, which is called Supélec. Supélec is an electrical engineering school, and both of them are now merged, and they are called Centrale Supélec. So now we change names. It's like taking Princeton and Rutgers and put them together. It makes Princeton Rutgers. Well, we are Centrale Supélec. So anyway. We want to look at combustion dynamics, and this appears in many systems. You can have that in boilers, very simple domestic boilers, 1 kilowatt or 10 kilowatt thermal power, and this can exhibit instabilities. You can have that in process heaters, 1 megawatt. You can have that in gas turbines, 100 megawatts, and you can have combustion dynamics in very large power plants. They can exhibit oscillations, which can be quite dangerous. In fact, these instabilities can have very bad effects on the systems. They produce strong oscillations. These oscillations produce fatigue of the structures. The fluxes, the heat fluxes to the walls are intensified. The burners can be destroyed by these augmented heat fluxes. We go to high pressure now in various systems, and as a consequence, the efficiency is increasing of the system in general, but the density of energy is higher, and as a consequence, this is more susceptible to instability. We have more compact design, so we gain in weight, but also we lose in damping. So the systems are less well damped, and again, they are more susceptible to oscillations. We try to be lean, to operate in a lean regime to bring down the nitric oxide production. But this poses problems in terms of stability of the flame, and again, this may be susceptible to instabilities. So let me just show a few cases and exemplify what happens under combustion dynamics. So the first case is a domestic boiler, and this domestic boiler exhibited an oscillation of about a few hertz, just about a few hertz. And you can see that in this case, if you look at the flame and the walls, you can see that this produces a breathing sort of oscillation. You see the walls are moving due to this oscillation in pressure inside the burner. It's a coupled motion between the pressure inside this system, the flame, which provides the heat release fluctuation, and you see that the flames are moving up and down, and the walls are actually moving, and the manufacturer wanted us to understand and to suppress, of course, these oscillations. You could not run this in your house like that. So it was, and of course, we found the ways to do that. A bigger configuration where we have instabilities is that of gas turbines. You know, the gas turbines are very useful for producing electricity in various places. You can have very large gas turbines. They don't take a large amount of space. It's very easy to place somewhere and produce electricity with this system. And these gas turbines are now essentially working in the lean premixed regime. So they operate lean and premixed to bring down the pollution, to bring down the nitric oxides. The previous gas turbines were producing a lot of nitric oxides. Those which are now using this premixed combustion system produce much less nitric oxides, and exponentially less. In fact, you know that if the temperature is brought down in the combustor, you have less NOx, because this is the Zeldovich mechanism, which is exponential with the temperature. And here you bring down the temperature, and so you bring down the nitric oxides. Of course, if you bring it too low, then you have too much carbon monoxide. So you have just the right point, and that's where you want to operate this combustor. So these systems have oscillations, and you can see a piece of equipment there which is broken due to these combustion instabilities here. Of course, the most spectacular instabilities are observed in rocket engines. In the early days of rocket propulsion, a number of such problems occurred. In fact, a lot of work was done because of this problem. When the Saturn V rocket was launched to go to the moon, during the program, at one point, there was what was called the instability crisis. The engine, the F1 engine, had instabilities. And it took about a year and a little more even to fix that. Otherwise, the engine would not hold during the flight. And it took a lot of testing, a lot of effort to be able to suppress this instability. So here you see a rocket engine after a high frequency instability. You see everything is broken down. In Europe, we have the Ariane rocket, which was launched starting in the 1980s. The first flight was successful, and the second flight was a failure. It was a combustion instability at 2,700 hertz. I was part of the committee to look at the problem. So I remember well this. It took us some time to understand what was going on and to fix the problem and have the rocket fly back into and go back into launching. So in this problem of gas turbines, this attracts a lot of work currently, and the problem here is that the system is complex. You have a flow which is rotating due to swirlers. You have boundary conditions which are complicated because on the upstream of this gas turbine, you see this is the combustor here. On the upstream side, you have a compressor. On the downstream, you have a turbine. And so these are difficult boundary conditions. In addition, you have all these complicated channels bringing down the premixed flow. And you stabilize the flame here using recirculation. You have swirling, which produces this recirculation. And then the gases are exhausted here. This is one case. This is a Rolls-Royce gas turbine. And so when you want to understand what goes on here, you have to take care of a turbulent swirling flame, resonant acoustic characteristics of the system, reduce damping rates, because essentially all that is just metallic, and so there are very little damping, and complicated boundary conditions formed by the compressor and the turbine. This is another view of this gas turbine. It's a derivative of an aircraft engine, and you see the combustors are located around the engine outside, and these are lean premixed combustors. And so what we need is to develop tools to predict instabilities and, of course, fix that. And numerical simulation of these instabilities is difficult, but this is the way we go. And I will tell you more about that later. The mechanism, the basic mechanism for these instabilities is shown here. Of course, you have many other possibilities, but this is one. So let's assume that you have velocity fluctuations here, and this will act on the flow, will act on the instabilities of the flow. Usually these are shear flows, so they have instabilities. And you can also modulate the injectors and produce equivalence ratio fluctuations. This will perturb the heat release. So the heat release will be fluctuating here, will produce pressure fluctuations here. The heat release also can produce convected waves of temperature, fluctuations in temperature, and we call them entropy waves. And this will interact with the nozzle downstream and produce pressure fluctuations, and or interact with the chamber here, and you get pressure fluctuations, and you can modulate the air and fuel supply and go back here and have this mechanism. So you see it's a coupled phenomenon, and we will see that in various configurations. Let me show you this case three. This is it's an injector. It's a staged injector. You have a multi-point injection of liquid fuel. And in this case, it's a device which looks a little bit like what you get in an aircraft combustor. So on this side is the injector. The flow goes in this direction. What you see here is the flame. So the dark regions are regions of recirculation. So you have a recirculation here and another one here. The flame is also touching the walls here because the confinement is perhaps too strong here. And you will see what happens as we change the staging. So at first, so in principle, yeah. Do you hear it? Yeah. So this is, yeah. So you saw that at the beginning, the flame was stable, but you could see that there were perturbations. And as we change the staging, you get into a region where the thing is oscillating. It interacts with the acoustic waves in the system, and you have oscillation. So this is what we get in most cases. You change a parameter, everything is fine, and suddenly the system becomes unstable. So this is what we want to predict. We want to see, are we able to say at that point, this will become unstable. So the, again, the mechanism of combustion instability can be described very roughly using this this feedback loop. On one side, you have the flow. It is perturbed. This perturbation produces heat release fluctuations in the combustion, and this constitutes sources to an acoustic field, and you have a feedback which takes place here. So what are the conditions for the feedback to operate? You need a certain phase. If the phase or if the delay is right, then you can get into an instability regime. In addition, what you need is that the gain be sufficiently high so that it is larger than the damping. And if you have these conditions, you can have this oscillation taking place. And this shows a little more of what I've just shown in another slide. It's again a block diagram which shows all the processes that can take place. On one side, you have these boundary conditions, which are important, which give you the impedance on the two sides of the system. For example, in this room, the walls are essentially rigid, so the impedance is infinite in this case. So whatever you push with your pressure on these walls, they don't move. So they don't respond. They have a zero velocity. You cannot move these walls with the pressure fluctuations. They are so heavy that they don't move. But in the combustor, the injector can be very sensitive to what it gets. So if the injector is not very stiff, it gets a pressure fluctuation. It responds with velocity or mass flow rate, and as a consequence, you may have an additional fluctuation in heat release, and this will come back through the loop. The other processes which are important here are injection, mixing, atomization, vaporization. If you have a two-phase flow, the flame can interact with the walls. Of course, the walls are important for acoustics, and in general, the system is important to set up the acoustics. And then you have the heat release, which produces entropy waves and which produces also pressure waves, and this is returned through the acoustics. This is just to show the simplest experiment that you can build in your garage. You can have that at your home. Yeah, you can play with that. So you buy a small device which gives you a flame, and you put a few tubes, and then you insert the flame inside the tubes. I have to exit that and try to find where the film is. It's here. So it's an organ pipe here. It looks like, and in fact, you can use that to play music. And this is a view of the flame as it is when it is in the quartz tube. You can see that the flame is, you place it higher and you see a vortex developing at the tip. And so you produce, the flame is elongated, it produces a patch of combustible mixture, and this burns, and this produces the source of heat. And this is a mechanism which is repeated, and you have the cycle taking place here. So this is a simple device. This is called the Ricoh tube. The Ricoh tube has attracted a lot of work, but it's too simple as a device to represent combustion instabilities. Nevertheless, a lot of people have played with Ricoh tubes. And you can play with that because it's so simple. You can look at how the flame dynamics operates in this case. It's nice. This is another case that we studied now many years ago. It's a paper that has been very successful. In this paper, we were looking at a system which was pre-mixed, and the combustion instability was driven by vortices. You will see them in a minute. And you see that when the system is stable, what you have here, you see these dark regions, these are recirculation behind these steps here. At that point, we were not very audacious. We thought we could not put a big quartz wall, window, so we put a small one. Unfortunately, we could have been much more courageous, but this is how we were. And you see that the window just looked at this jet here and a little bit of the jet on the sides here. And air and propane is blowing in this. This is a backward-facing step system with multiple injection. And the oscillation took place at 530 hertz. This was done with Thierry Poinceau, Arnaud Trouvé. Arnaud is now at University of Maryland. Thierry Poinceau is at Serfax. And Denis Venant, he's in our lab. And so what we were seeing is when the system was stable, it's like that. You have this recirculation taking place, the jets, and the flames is stabilized here. And when the system becomes unstable, you can see that the luminosity is much larger. In fact, you break the window here due to this oscillation. The window broke. And in addition, you see that the combustion takes place much closer to the steps. And what is behind? We put Schlieren, and this is what you see. You see vortices which are formed cyclically, and they interact. These two vortices interact. This is at a later time. They interact here more strongly, producing a lot of turbulence here. And you can see that. So these were some of the first images of emission from this system. This was done by displacing a photomultiplier on a specified grid. Using a computer, you could displace the photomultiplier and take an image at every point. And since the system is phased by the oscillation, you can reconstruct the image. This is not a direct image. At that time, we didn't have the cameras that you have now in your phone. At that time, it was difficult to get an image like that. It took a lot of effort to make that image, but we were able to actually get the spatial pattern of heat release fluctuation associated with these vortices at various instances during the cycle. So that's what you see here. It took a lot of effort and sweat, but we were quite happy with that. Later on, now it's coming close to us now, we started doing large eddy simulations of this system, and you can see a version of that. You see the vortex is developing here, and this is a false system at 530 hertz. That was done by Angèle Berger and a number of people, including Thierry Poinceau, and you can see that the vortex is developing, but in this case, only a single vortex was calculated. Now, it's quite possible to calculate the whole system. But at that time, we didn't have the computer power to do that. You can see that it compares. Not quite, because here you have periodic boundary conditions, and here you have real vortices. But it looks very much alike, yeah. Another experiment that we did in the earlier part in the 20th century is this system here. You have a duct and you have a stabilizer here. The stabilizer has the shape of a V. It's like a V gutter. It's what we use in aircraft engines to stabilize the flames in afterburners. This is essentially used in military aircraft, and these aircraft have sometimes combustion instabilities, these afterburners. In addition, this is a very nice flame to study because it's confined, but it's stabilized continuously. So what is the stabilization process? Again, a recirculation of gases here. Hot gases are recirculating here. The cold stream, which comes from here, air and propane, reaches these hot gases, and there is a process here of ignition taking place. This is one of the problems that Frank Marble studied with Tom Adamson. And so you have a very nice, actually, solution of that region here. Ed Law has also worked on that problem. So you see here the flame is developing here. And so that's a turbulent flame in a duct. Typically, the velocity is 40 meters per second or more. You can stabilize at high speed using an obstacle. The obstacle stabilize. Without the obstacle, the flame is blown out. With the obstacle, you stabilize the flame in the... Of course, you have some head loss, but the flame is stabilized at high speed. And you know it's difficult to stabilize flames at high speed, but this is a way to do that. And so now what happens when you have this flame and you submit that to acoustic waves? And we did experiments of that with Arnaud Trouvé and Ken Yu, who is also at University of Maryland. And you can see now that you form right here structures, and the flame is susceptible to essentially all frequencies. It is very susceptible to oscillations, and you find this, the wavelengths is actually equal to the velocity divided by the frequency. You have the wavelengths, and as you change the frequency, you diminish the wavelengths. For example, you increase the frequency, diminish the wavelengths, and you can see that the flame responds to what you impose in terms of pressure, acoustic pressure. And this is again a calculation that was done by Christophe Notin around the year 2000, where you can see that you reproduce something like that using LES. Again, we can do much better now. This is an early calculation of what is going on here. So basically, what we've seen is that we have the flow here, combustion, acoustics, and this is the main loop to study. So we have to study the flame dynamics here. We have to study the burner acoustics here in some way. The acoustics is an important part in this problem. And so we'll spend some time actually working on the acoustics. Now, let's go to a few basic questions. Why is combustion so susceptible to instabilities? So one reason is that you have a lot of power. The power density in our systems is very large. Of course, the extreme case is shown here. Here you have an engine. It's the Vulcain engine. The chamber has 50 liters, and the power that is expended is about 2.5 gigawatts. So it's like two power plants, like two electrical power plants is in a single 50 liters. So you get the power, which is enormous, of 50 gigawatts per cubic meter. That's very, very large. So if you have a cubic meter of rocket engine, you have 50 gigawatts, because you burn typically 250 kilograms of oxygen in this case. It's rich in hydrogen, and you burn. So what is burning is actually oxygen in hydrogen. So you take the 250 kilograms per second of oxygen, multiply by the right power per energy per unit mass, and you get this 50 gigawatts per cubic meter. So even a small amount of that, even if you have 20% pressure fluctuations, this is what happens. Sometimes you can get oscillations which are so high as 20% of the pressure in the chamber. The pressure is 100 bar, so you have 20 bars of fluctuations, at, let's say, 1 kilohertz. Not in this engine. This engine has not yet exhibited oscillations like that. But when you have them, this is what you get. It's enormous, absolutely. Nevertheless, this is only 0.4 megawatts per cubic meter. So a small amount of this power put into the acoustics is sufficient to have very high oscillations. So you see the ratio between these two is really small. So a small amount of the power available can produce a very strong oscillation. The second point, and this was discovered very, very early, is that combustion involves time delays. In fact, when you take fuel and oxidizer and send it into the chamber, they are burning at a later time. You have a delay. And you know, a system which has a delay can become unstable. This is your typical experience with your shower. You know that when the distance between the tap and the shower is sufficient, when you operate the tap, you feel it after a while. So you get something very hot. So suddenly you see it's hot, you turn it back to have it cooler. But at the time, you've gone too far. It takes a little while, and suddenly you get very cold water, and now you feel very bad and turn it back, and it's unstable. So to do that, you have to have a small flow velocity and a long shower tube and not understand that there is a delay. You know, a lot of people don't understand delays. For example, people want to the economy to react on the spot. You do something, and immediately it has to respond. No, it doesn't. It takes a while, you know. To build somebody's mind takes a while. Everything is with a delay. You need a delay. You cannot do everything on the spot. So coming back to this, if you take a system like that, this is a second order differential equation, and you see here I set a delay. So this is not x, it's x t minus tau. Now you transform that using a Taylor series, and you take the first term of this Taylor series, it's here. You see omega zero squared times dx by dt times tau, so it comes here. And you see that when this term here is negative, this becomes unstable. So it's sufficient that 2 zeta, so the damping here, has to be smaller than the product of omega zero, this is the frequency, the angular frequency, times the delay tau. And so if tau is sufficient, this is negative and it's unstable. So the time lag in combustion is a main reason for instability. And this was understood very early. For example, Luigi Crocco, who was a professor here. Luigi Crocco was a very famous professor who is from Princeton here. Yeah. So you've learned about Luigi Crocco. Have you heard the name? Or in fluid mechanics, there is the Crocco theorem. And so he was a professor. I was able to talk to him because the later part of his life he spent in France. His wife loved Paris, and so he quit Princeton just to because his wife wanted to be in Paris. So it's amazing. But like that, we had many occasions to interact. Crocco was an older man at that time, and I was very young, and I thought, now I'm going to solve your problems. I'm going to, and he said, you know, it's very difficult. It's not an easy problem to solve. Many years after, I'm still working on it, yes. But Luigi Crocco, at that time, that was in the 1950s, they developed this, what is called the sensitive time lag. Because the time lag, not only there is a time lag, but it is sensitive to the conditions. It changes. So it's the so-called sensitive time lag theory, which is still used. And a lot of the work of Crocco is known in this field. another person who has worked in these ideas, and I'll tell you more about that, is Tian. Tian was a professor at Caltech, and later on he left the United States and went to China and developed the rocket program in China. And the third person in those early days who was working with these ideas is my advisor, Frank Marble, here. And he was a professor at Caltech. He was a very nice advisor. We could chat a lot together, and we had a number of very nice conversations. I saw him in 2013. I came with my computer and showed him what we were doing, and we looked at the various problems together. So this is one theory which has been very useful and continues to be used in this field. Now, another point in combustion instability is that the systems that we are using are resonant. You know, all the confined systems, combustion chambers, this equipment, they have boundary conditions and they are confined. And as a consequence, you have modes, you have resonant modes. For example, in the organ pipe, the resonant system is the pipe. The pipe has two open boundary conditions, and you have modes that can be developed in this pipe. And these modes will, of course, intervene in this process. In fact, you have two types of modes, essentially longitudinal. When the wavelength is very large compared to the dimension, the mode is longitudinal. And when the wavelength is smaller than the typical dimension, you may have also higher order modes, which are transverse. We will learn that. So here you have a classification. This was done by in 1968 by Marcel Barrère and Forman Williams. And so you have what they recognize is system instabilities. Instabilities that are present in the whole system. The mode is something which operates in the full system, including the inlet, the chamber, the nozzle. This is for aero engines. In the gas turbine, it's essentially the compressor, the turbine, and the combustor. So these are system instabilities, essentially longitudinal wave propagation, low frequency. Then you have chamber instabilities. Chamber instabilities are essentially located in the chamber. You have, for example, a transverse mode of this chamber. The wavelength is smaller. It's smaller than the transverse dimension, and this is in the high frequency range. It's higher frequency, let's say. And then there is another type of instability, which are intrinsic. You have a lot of instabilities for flames. Flames are not stable, and one of them, the famous instability, is the Darius-Landau instability. You know, Lev Landau is a very famous Russian physicist. He knew everything about physics. You find in Landau all the things you need. You don't have to look for more, not quite. It's not always easy to read Landau if you try. And the other one is Georges Darius. He was a Frenchman. And both of them independently discovered that flames are always unstable for all wavelengths, that you have an instability which is due to the fact that you have a big difference in density across the flame, and this makes this Darius-Landau instability. It turns out that Darius was also an alumnus from École Centrale. Of course, and in fact, I met him. He came once. He was very old then. He was over 90, I guess. And he came in 1968 and gave us a lecture on the relativistic traveler. What would happen if you travel at very, very high speed, near the speed of light? What happens then? And so he was interested in the later part of his life. And he also invented a very, very interesting a wind turbine, which is a vertical axis wind turbine, looks like an egg beater. Have you seen this, Darius? Well, this is the Darius who also worked on this instability. Well, anyway, we won't be working on this here. This is more specialized, doesn't involve acoustics. We are interested in more system and chamber instabilities. There are already a lot of things here. But basically, this is also quite an interesting topic. This shows just the timeline, and I've placed here Croco, Tsien, Marble, Forman Williams. Marcel Barrère was a pioneer in rocket propulsion in France. Benzin, Fred Kulik here, I put myself as well. Vigor Young, he has done a lot of work in this field. Anne Dowling, she has done a lot of active control work. She's from Cambridge. Thierry Poinceau is here. And the younger people like Thierry Schuller, Tim Leuven, and but of course it doesn't show everybody. It's just a very, very small group of people. Combustion research is carried out by many more people, and the literature now is quite broad in this field, and it's just to give you a little bit of what was happening. So what was happening here is a lot of theoretical studies, because they didn't have the computers. So they needed to do a lot of theory, and of course some experiments. Here, further synthesis. There is a famous report, the NASA 194 report, which compiles all the knowledge that was available on combustion instability in the rocket engine area, and that was in 1974. And then we continued experiments. A lot of experiments took place in the 1980s, 1990s. Active control has been developing, you know, trying to counteract oscillations using control principles. That was very attractive. And then more recently, a lot of work is being done on gas turbines, numerical modeling, active control, scale up of and the LES, you know, trying to use LES. LES can be very useful for studying combustion dynamics processes. So the objectives are identify the mechanisms. So that's I tried to show you some of these mechanisms already. Illustrate these mechanisms by experiments. And they can also serve to validate predictions. Are you able to predict the parameter which gives you the instability. Derive theoretical and modeling tools to analyze combustion dynamics. Engineers would love to have engineering tools that could tell them this may become unstable at that point. And during the design process, usually you don't look at the dynamics, but then you build the combustor, and experiment, and suddenly it becomes unstable, and then you have to fix that. So if we had engineering tools, and we have more and more, you will see. And then provide elements for the prediction of linear, nonlinear stability of combustors. You have a lot of many processes can take place, and so we have to study all that. And of course, to begin with, now we have to get into the equations. You cannot do without them. It's impossible to study things like that without actually looking at the theory. So the basic theory is first to look at acoustics. So who has been exposed to acoustics? Do you have, yeah, in the, in, all right. Some of this material might be a little too simple for you, but nevertheless, I'm going to do that. And then we will go to, so here what we do is the basic equations of acoustics, plane waves, harmonic waves, plane modes in ducts, harmonic spherical waves, and the acoustic energy balance. So that's acoustics for everybody. It's acoustics 001. It's the... And then we will go to the reactive flows, acoustics of reactive flows, accounting for heat release fluctuations, compact flames, the energy balance when you have when you are in a reactive flows, the equations for reactive flows, unified framework, what was called the unified framework, and then what are the theoretical methods in flame dynamics. So perhaps we have still 5 minutes. Perhaps we can have a small session of questions before we stop and rest for a quarter of an hour. So a few minutes of questions. Don't hesitate. Of course, I didn't tell you at the beginning, but you can certainly raise your hands and say, I don't understand what you are saying. And you can... Yes.
So you showed a couple of cases of oscillation after the treatment. So the experiments that you were doing, how do you force these oscillations?
So you have to. So the question is, how do you actually get your oscillations in an experiment? So there are two ways. One way is to, let's say, open loop. You have loudspeakers, driver units. You can have mechanical devices that will impose fluctuations to the flame. This is when the flame is stable, but you want to study its response. So on one way, you just put in systems to perturb the flame. Various kinds of systems, acoustic systems, mechanical systems. That's a possibility. The other one, which is quite interesting, is you have a system there, and for example, you change the equivalence ratio, and suddenly you get to a point where the system, which had a small level of fluctuation, suddenly jumps to a high level of fluctuation. This is what I showed in one experiment, and it's unstable, immediately unstable, when you cross that parameter, when the parameter has been changed to that point. And for example, we had an experiment where, I'll show that, you have a piston in a duct, and the duct is finished by a grid, and you have flames sitting on the grid. And you change the position of the piston in the duct, so you change the modes that can get in, the frequencies, and there you see the first mode coming in, the second mode, the third mode, switching taking place. So by changing a parameter, like the geometrical parameter, you can change the stability. Another case is you have a swirler, and we thought maybe we can change the swirl number. The swirl number is the ratio of the azimuthal momentum to the actual momentum. You change the swirl number by changing the blade angle. And we had students from high school who developed for us a continuously changing swirl number swirler, where the blades were changing with an engine, a small motor. And at a certain value of the swirl number, the system became unstable. So parameters, by changing parameters, you can get into an instability region. Another question, and we stop. Yeah. Yes, yeah. The equivalence ratio, the question is, the equivalence ratio also influences stabilization. Yes, on one side, you know that the system is dependent on the equivalence ratio in terms of the stable situation. But this is one side. The other side is the dynamical aspects. So you have let's say a static aspect of the equivalence ratio, you have a dynamical aspect. So, and of course, they can be related. If the flame is not very well stabilized, it might be more susceptible to perturbations, and this may also explain why it responds strongly to oscillations, yeah.
And also, there is a really Taylor
So the Rayleigh-Taylor instability, Rayleigh-Taylor is the instability which is due to gravity and to the fact that you have two regions of low and high density. And if they are upside down, they...
Cold air and yes. Cold,
yeah. You do have natural instabilities of that kind. For example, when you have a diffusion flame in air, you know you have a flickering effect, which is essentially related to buoyancy effects, yeah, which is close to Rayleigh theorem. Yeah.
Yeah, intermixed flames.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. So relax for a quarter of an hour, and we meet again at 10. So take a